Okay, so my name is John Rostakis. I'm one of the researchers for what's called the FLOC Society Project here in Quito, in Ecuador. And FLOC stands for Free, Libre, Open Knowledge. And the project is the FLOC Society Project, which is aiming at developing a framework for transitioning Ecuador from the current economic model that it has to something called a social knowledge economy. And I am joined here by my good friends, Robin Murray, who has been very active. He's an economist, he's been associated with the London School of Economics, he's been associated with the development of fair trade in the United Kingdom and internationally, and he's one of the consultants that we brought to Quito to work with us on the research that we're doing here. And on my left, Margie Mandel, who is a professor at Concordia University in Canada, who is one of the primary researchers and academics on the social knowledge, on the social economy, not only in Canada, but internationally. So she was also invited here to work with us on our research for the FLOC Society Project. And then finally, we're joined by Annabelle, whom I don't know your last name, so I'll just say Annabelle for now, who we met here. She's an old friend of Margie Mandel's, but is an anthropologist and has been working on a number of projects, one of the key ones here in Ecuador, in a community called Salinas, which we'll be talking about later on, and on which she did her PhD.
Mm-hmm. Right? That's right.
So maybe I can just start this conversation with maybe a bit more of a description on FLOC and how we all convene here. The FLOC Society Project has been running now for about 7 months in terms of the research work. And my field of research is on the relationship between social knowledge on the one hand and the social economy on the other, and on the social and public institutions that relate to transitioning to and developing a social knowledge economy here. We met together here last week around the FLOC Society Summit, which was an international summit that brought together activists, hacktivists, economists, academics, and practitioners to look at the research that we had done on this transition from the current economic paradigm to a new social knowledge economy. And our focal point in our conversations was on the relationship between social knowledge on the one hand and the proposals that we had developed around the role of the state vis-a-vis the social economy and the commons as well, and how those questions can relate to each other in the transition to a new governance model of in terms of the role of the state, but also in terms of the kind of policies that we wanted to promote that would link this transition to a social knowledge economy in a new kind of relationship between the state on the one hand and civil society on the other. So that was the focal point of our conversation. Over four-day period. And so perhaps what I can do is simply ask my other partners here what some of their impressions, some of the key impressions you took away from the summit, and also from the dialogue we had at our table around these questions of the relationship to the state, to the civil society, and around the public and civil institutions. And the role they need to play and how they need to change to realize this vision of a social knowledge economy here. Not just here, but perhaps more generally, anywhere. Is that a lot to ask for?
Yes. I think we can take a stab at it, perhaps.
But why don't we give it a shot?
Me first?
Yeah.
Let me back up, I think, for a minute and say that we didn't arrive here cold, so to speak. John wrote three excellent papers, in fact four, because he co-authored a fourth one on information technology, communication information technologies, and we had an ongoing dialogue between the three of us, two of us, commenting on the papers, asking lots of questions. I know very little about Ecuador beyond what I learned from John and some of the documents. I read the plan, the very interesting development plan for Ben Vivier. And so coming to the summit, we had this background information, and John very John identified many challenges here, and also made proposals for possible change, new policies, new policy measures, new ways in which the state and civil society can interact in a way that could have more positive results in the social and solidarity economy, and in sharing knowledge across regions and actors within Ecuador, but also internationally through the experiences and research that we had done in our respective countries and in other places that we visited. And also FLOC brought together people from everywhere, I think. Certainly a lot of representation from Latin America. So for me, the summit itself was a coming together of a conversation between three people, now with an opportunity to dialogue with about a dozen people on a very, you know, in a very intense way over 3 days, and reflect on the ideas that John had developed and that we worked on together, and having the benefit of people from Ecuador around the table was indispensable, particularly since they represented government, they represented civil society, social economy, actors, academics, and then there were others who were from other countries. So I think that when we talk about social knowledge, this was one way in which we were actually engaging in developing that process, in sharing our knowledge and testing some of the proposals that we had come forward with. For me, I leave this with the hope that it's an ongoing conversation, and in that sense that we've created a commons where we can continue to have this dialogue. I won't go into any specifics now, maybe we can do that in conversation. There are many challenges here, and I would pose them as challenges rather than problems. Many of them are similar to what we would find in other parts of the world. Many of them are very specific to Ecuador. I really respect and admire the openness of our dialogue and the capacity to engage in critical discussion. I think that was very rich, and particularly since we had representatives of government at the table with us. We even had somebody from the central bank with us at one point, which did not in any way change the nature of the conversation. So that candid, open, reflective process is invaluable. Maybe I'll let Robin have a go. I could go on and on, and I don't want to.
Well, I think two things came out of the few days we made, two dominant things. The first is this, that a sense I'd already got that the 20th century was a century of private industrial capitalism, where the private rose to, you know, enormous scale, whereas the 19th century had been small scale. We had industrial capitalism. We also had other ways of doing that. So you had private capital, but you also had a lot of small farmers and small firms, the rise of the cooperative movement, really throughout Western Europe, and by the 1890s, spreading much wider. But then came the period of scale, Henry Ford, and everything was economies of scale, vast plants, chemicals, or whatever. And that was the rule. And how you organized that was highly centralized, vertically controlled. And whether it was the private or indeed the public, that was the model, a vertical model of control of these very large organized forms of production. Of course, what's happened now in the last, 30 years, is that information and knowledge have now assumed very much are far much more important, I think, than the actual machines. So when we've been here, we've seen relics of the 20th century in terms of the plants we saw the other day for making yarn. And these were actually imported. They were second-hand machines from Belgium from the 1960s. And we implanted them, and the main thing then was to have the machines and then train up on them. This was a complex thing and rather remarkable, 20th century machines. But now, as innovation has become more important, and the way in which we've got to get production responding to a very diverse consumer taste. Whereas in the 20th century, you could produce standardized yarns. Now you have to have specialized yarns and specialized cheeses. All the things we've seen, these are specialized. We've therefore got to have responsive forms of production, but B, constant innovation in products, in the way we do things, as well as in science and technology. Now, what the main difference between machines and information is that to produce another machine is quite costly. You can produce one, but the next one is also going to be considerable cost. But once you've produced a new idea, or a new product idea, or a new way of doing the thing, to reproduce that is virtually costless. And then that skews why privatize that? What is the logic of actually stopping that spread in all sorts of different ways? That's the central issue that we are now confronting. And it has burst open in the form of software with Linux and so on, which was a theme of the conference, and has just been completely fascinating to me as I am an economist, but I also see myself as a historian of the present, to see over the last 15 years the way in which open software contributed as a commons freely and distributed freely has outcompeted those like Microsoft, who have organized these things in the 20th century way, which is to control it, is completely fascinating. And what has happened in software has been spreading. So it has spread, and we saw lots of examples of this in relation to Ecuador, not just from software, but to culture, to science, to new ways of running cooperatives, as a matter of fact. So all this knowledge, which has become so central, it doesn't make sense to do it in the 20th century way and to try and vertically control it. What is now emerged is a completely new paradigm of horizontal cooperation. Whatever form it takes, sometimes you don't actually have any organization, you don't have to form a company to produce an open source software program. It is a question of people having the enthusiasm to do this, that, or the other. And the whole rise of social innovation and the social economy reflects that. It is an economy of enthusiasm, of will, of people doing things very often voluntarily because it means something to them as people. That is a very different economy than when they were privatizing everything. And very interestingly, always the argument has been that unless you privatize the knowledge, you won't get people producing new knowledge. What we've seen over the last 15 years is in all these fields, knowledge and science and so on, people are doing it not so that they can then sit back and go and retire in the Cayman Islands on the back of something they've once done, and then restricting its circulation, but actually spreading it. And the first thing that has really struck me during this week is that in Ecuador, with its challenges of development, where it has been importing knowledge and either having to pay for it through paying for patents or receiving it as aid, which is a particular version of knowledge from those who are giving the aid, were in a way attempting to structure Ecuador's development according to their model of what they think is the right way of doing things. And what is so striking is that we see emerging in Ecuador a different kind of economy. Whereas instead of actually exporting primary resources in return for this paid for knowledge and products and various other blueprints and technology transfer, we are moving to the possibility of having the import substitution of knowledge, i.e. developing its own knowledge capacity specific to Ecuador, drawing on the extraordinary riches, which is very exciting to observe, of the indigenous peoples and of traditional knowledge, not left as traditional, but shared and then developed into a modern form. This is something, we saw it in the biodiversity, that the extraordinary biodiversity in Ecuador, this is a potential extraordinary resource, not just for Ecuador, but for sharing with the world. And so, on the one hand, there will be import substitution of knowledge. On the other hand, the resources, which in the next century are going to be the crucial thing, resource productivity, the way we use scarce resources, because we can't use them as we did in the 20th century, how these, with a shared knowledge, developed in Ecuador in cooperation with others who are sharing this, who share the same perspective internationally, but actually develop the specific Ecuadorian resources for themselves, and it's a different economic model. Mm-hmm. That came through so strongly in table after table, reporting on their experiences of how this principle of open rather than closed, of shared and common rather than proprietary, was a new way of thinking about this development and the economy. And very briefly on the second thing that came out is that there must have been, 150 to 200 people who came. And if you just listened to the way each group spoke, and they worked on it individually, it wasn't as though it was all shared, it was mostly working groups. There was a new paradigm, as we might put it. It emerged. People used the same terms, it was the same way of looking at it. I thought of it as a new aesthetic of a way of doing things, whatever it was. And this was so remarkably shared. What was it? It was open. It was inclusive, socially inclusive. It was democratic. It almost reinterpreted that older idea of individual freedom in terms of social openness, which is free, but in a particular sense, which is not just individual freedom, but freedom achieved individually as part of a society. And I got the definite feeling, as the historian part of me, it reminded me very much of the 17th century in England, when you had the rise of the merchant class faced with the old feudal class. And they had a particular aesthetic which clashed in a civil war. And in France, it happened later, in the late 18th century. A new class was emerging in the 17th century. And the same thing happened in the late 19th century with the labor movements, where you would have something equivalent to flock, which recognized the significance of labor as part of the new industrial age. And it was a coming together to challenge the way in which industrial capitalism is developing. My very strong impression from this week was that we saw almost the emergence of a new class, a class who realized the significance of open knowledge. Most of the people there were knowledge workers of one kind or another, not just professional, engineers and economists and agronomists, but also traditional societies and their knowledge, popular knowledge, that was absolutely central to all this in a cooperative way. And that is a real challenge to the old proprietary capitalism that we've inherited from the 20th century.
If I could just add one sentence, because I think what was so unique with this at this summit was the way in which it was constructed. That you had three consecutive days of roughly 5 hours to discuss, which seems like a lot, and in fact our experience was that it wasn't enough, and discuss ideas and then concrete proposals around so many issues, agriculture, energy, the social economy, which is a broader subject that captures many of these topics. And then to come together, that was hard. You know, these were long working days, but it was a crescendo, and as it came together at the end, you really had this feeling, there was tremendous passion expressed at the end, but that it is possible to construct 3 or 4 days that's not the old standard 20th century version of a conference where people passively listen to people delivering papers, but that everyone has an input into this process. So I think the enthusiasm at the end was not so much about coming out with a whole set of principles, that would be great, but it was much more a celebration of this capacity to dialogue and to have a conversation with the prospect of it ongoing.
I want to come back to some of the points that you raised. And what we're talking about, what you're describing, is the rise of what people are calling cognitive capitalism, which is sort of a transmutation of capitalism from a focus on material goods and material resources as the kind of the inputs to the creation and accumulation of capital and wealth, to the transmutation and commodification of immaterial, right? Of ideas, not just ideas. We spend a lot of time talking about social relationships, about social networks, about online communities, and you know, things like brands. The branding of things, not only in terms of, you know, commercial brands, but of colors, of words, of ideas themselves. And so this transformation of capital and of capitalism from the commodification of material things and resources to the enclosure, privatization, and commodification of the immaterial was really, in a sense, kind of the turning point that sparked this enormous interest in protecting what is immaterial, protecting what is personal. Whether we're talking about personal information, about our personal lives, data that is now being, you know, circulated, privatized, and enclosed online, right? To the commodification of what are traditionally social relationships of caring, the provision of home care, of health care, of education, of recreation, of culture formation. And so this whole sort of problematic around how do you protect what is social and what is common and what is immaterial from the traditional capitalist process of enclosure, privatization, and commodification was very much at the heart, both of the Flock project and of the papers that we were discussing. And what we're talking about is two very different notions of what markets are and what markets could be. And so we spent a lot of time talking about the social economy and the, you know, the principles and values that drive the social economy and social economy organizations like associations, cooperatives, and so on. And the principles of mutuality, of solidarity, of reciprocity that animate and give meaning to those kinds of social relationships. And the danger of, in a sense, hollowing out the content of social relationships from these kind of mutualist and social meanings into something that is purely a utilitarian use of relationships with the creation of profit, of commodifying social relationships. So the idea of social knowledge is very much the idea of protecting the common quality of these immaterial things, of knowledge production and knowledge sharing. And that social knowledge is an idea that knowledge is a commons, it's a common good. It's produced commonly and it should be shared commonly for common benefit, as opposed to being privatized for private benefit, right? So this has enormous implications for the kind of social institutions, the social organizations, the kind of the ways in which people interact with each other, in which communities operate, in which social organizations, how they define how people work together. It has enormous implications for what's the correlation between social knowledge as an ideal and the social organizations and the social relations that actually provide support and protection and realization of that ideal. So this is, I think, very much at the heart of what we were talking about. And a problem. How do you do that? How do you create or recreate the kind of social relationships that you were describing that arose in sort of the 19th century as a response to industrial capitalism through cooperatives, through trade unions? In a way, how do you organize human relationships as a kind of an antibody to these kind of capitalist commercial processes? And now we're faced with the same problem about how to do that in contention with, you know, this notion of cognitive capitalism where everything can be enclosed, everything can be privatized, everything can be commodified. And so what's the social reaction to that?
Well, you've talked about protection.
Mm.
And I'm not sure if this was in a way, the theme was how a social knowledge economy, or if we organize things mutually and among ourselves, actually, as in the case of software, becomes a much more adequate form of production and living than this cognitive capitalism, which is trying to do two things. There were two distinct themes, which not everyone always distinguished. One was a version of exploitation. That's to say, with the rise of the social knowledge economy, such as Linux, then capital was actually then almost using the free labor that had been contributed because people were enthusiastic about making new forms of software, and then appropriating it, that free labor, and then using it to expand in the old capital. So that was a theme of exploitation. But there was another theme, which I think is equally important, actually, and possibly more important, which is what capital in this age of information and knowledge does is it's not just taking information about ourselves. It is an acute study of each one of us. So that they know what each one of us is buying, doing, where we are, and so on. This is the development of this extraordinary capacity to trace individuals and their expressed desires, including their what they say on Facebook and so on, and then turning it against, as it were, returning it to them in the form of commodities. So that suddenly you find on, if you're using Google, you suddenly are faced with a whole set of adverts about something which you actually are interested in, where the pressure then is to go towards the commodity. And the way, so as against exploitation, I think there was a theme of alienation, of the alienation of what is personal to us, taken from us, and then returned back to us in the form of commodities and individualizing each other. And so the issue that we discussed was, on the one hand, of exploitation, how we would put a fence around our sharing so that if people wanted to use it to make money, they would have to pay the community who had paid it through a new form of license. That was a very innovative theme of the conference. But similarly, there was a question about how we prevent the alienation of all that is us and then return to us on terms which are not us, and how through developing common ways of producing and of living, which are not alienated but which are shared, produces a much more richer form of living. That's the point. It's not individualized and commodified, but it is shared a shared development of being rather than having, to put it like that. And one of the things we discussed during the week, curiously enough, was how the development of this modern form of capitalism and alienated being, as it were, has led to all sorts of the rise of curious diseases and unhappiness, actually. And the exciting thing about Quinn Vivia is that it is about living, it is not about having. And that not only is it perhaps, well, it is clearly more economically satisfactory to produce software collectively and many other things, culture too, and science when this is shared. But equally, it is more fulfilling to do these things. We saw many examples of this together, participate together in producing, in being together, on our own terms, collectively. But that actually produces a very much richer individual as well as collective life. And we saw wonderful examples of that. We've seen one when we went to the south of Quito, where people, for 8 years, in order to improve their lives together, reclaimed a true compass, which is a ravine, which had been used as rubbish and utterly neglected by the state, and people actually used it just to get rid of things that were not, they didn't want, as it were. This has been reclaimed by everyone, going every Sunday to reclaim a commons. Now, what came out of that is not just a beautiful park and the ravine made into something which was linked, was kind of the parallel to the canals of Venice. So we now have the beautiful ravines of Quito. But it wasn't just the reclaiming of that, is that the very process of doing that actually produced a richness in life, that you had produced it collectively together, so that every time you looked out of your house, which had also been developed through a cooperative and developed collectively, you've got the kind of satisfaction that we all get from having done something ourselves, rather than going to a mall and buying it in the shop.
I just want to follow up on this, because there is, I just want to make the point that the focus of the conference, for the most of the people at the conference, was on the immaterial. It was on the sort of, in a sense, the implications of the digital commons and what they mean to the problem of knowledge production and sharing broadly. Right? But just important to note that the work that still needs to be done is at the material level. It's in the real world of where people live and work and how they relate to each other, the food they eat, the houses they build, the kind of caring relations they offer to each other, to people that are vulnerable, and so on. So it was interesting because in our table, in our conversations, we did very much talk about this broader immaterial aspect. But a good deal of our conversation was on how do we continue to build the commons and the cooperative relationships that concretize and materialize these ideas, you know, of sharing and so on, in real relationships and in real organizations. And one of the first trips that we took, the first trip we took after the conference was in a community called Salina, again, to the south of Quito. And getting to understand and know El Salinero, which is an integral co-op or a system in this community, and just reflecting and talking to people about how their problem was not the question of social knowledge, not the question of the digital immaterial stuff. Their problem was how to actually reconstruct an economy that was, you know, a dependent economy in the old sort of latifundia hacienda system of the landlord and the tenants and the exploitation that took place there. So how do you reclaim, you know, an economy locally? So maybe the two.
Yeah, I'll just jump in for a second because pick up on John's segue, making the link between the immaterial and the material and the issues that we discussed and the kinds of projects that we've been involved in really for most of our adult life as researchers and practitioners. And you know, put that in a historical context, as Robin has done, and the role of the labor movement and the cooperative movement historically in mobilizing progressive change and the influence that it has had on progressive politics. It's very easy to say that we're just in a different world right now and we have to reconstruct everything. But the truth is that with the richness of the experiences, two of which we saw here, Salinas and then today in the south of Quito, are two of many experiences around the world in the north and south, but they are very fragmented. And so we don't use the word class, we don't even use the term class anymore, which is a mistake, but we don't. And so we have a series of patchwork experiences, which in my view really are, you know, rather than calling them patchwork, it's a jigsaw puzzle and the pieces fit. And we haven't been able, it's hard work to be able to conceptualize what is going on that is in fact representing the seeds of a new paradigm. And a stitching together of experiences where the material world is manifesting in different ways, in collective forms, in producing goods and services that respond to the desire to be, in as much as the desire to have. The project we saw today was really astounding, and even the way in which we were welcomed, and it was about a housing project, we thought, and correctly. But in fact, our first visit was through a ravine that is absolutely beautiful and that has been converted from a garbage dump into a public space, a commons with a bike path and beautiful gazebos and remarkable example of biodiversity. So I think that you know, if one were to be pessimistic, and I'm not, one could say, well, it's very easy for cognitive capitalism and global finance and so on to steamroll right over us because these are all such pieces of, you know, and we can all engage in these little initiatives, but they're fragile. On the other hand, where we have been helped enormously through the possibility of networking and technology is by bringing these experiences together and leveraging. And in some cases, it's easier than in others to be able to leverage also the way in which governments are, in some cases, capturing these because pragmatically it's useful for them to be able to capture these experiences and then claim them. In other cases, there are new and very interesting examples of the partner state, as John laid out, in as a hope, as a blueprint, perhaps for Ecuador under difficult conditions, but not impossible conditions. So I think that we have a lot of work to do that has to be part of the old and the new, the face-to-face communication that we experienced here, the visualization of the initiatives that we were very fortunate to visit, and very different, one in a remote community and the other in the really a suburb of a major city like Quito. We have to have these face-to-face exchanges, but to be able to take organizations like RIPES, for example, in the case of the social economy, which is an international organization now, that shares these experiences and then brings them to national governments, brings them to the United Nations, brings them to the big institutions like the OECD, the ILO, and so on. So we have to work at very, very different levels and have, so in that sense, the immaterial becomes an instrument of this drafting, if you will, or designing, co-designing of a new paradigm. And I think that the seeds are there, and the question is to take that jigsaw puzzle, piece it together, to try to begin to do the conceptualizing at the same time as people on the ground are arguing for very specific needs that have to be met, and lobbying or interfacing with government. You know, writing that story to compete with, to contest this dominant paradigm, which is sick. It's dysfunctional. We see that everywhere. And even in a country like Ecuador, sadly, where there's the potential for a different approach, unfortunately, the way in which the policy framework is being shaped is very much a part of the old universe, and not this new one. So, I think I'll stop there. But I when I teach my classes and I try to understand myself what is happening and how to communicate this to students and how to work with communities and organizations. One can despair that these are all fragments. I think that these are, the building blocks, some of which are reliant on the best of the traditions of the labor movement and the cooperative movement that are now being folded into these new initiatives. You know, where do we go with this? And in that sense, this conversation that we're having, the papers that we're writing, I think will be important.
If we took Salinas as an example, on the material side, what we saw was that we had a whole lot of very small producers. Some only had one cow, some had two, some had seven, and highly dispersed over the area. And the way in which the 20th century would do it is they could not produce milk. They couldn't get it to the market in time. They would therefore not have a living, and therefore they would be dispossessed, their land taken over, and they would then go to Quito to try and find employment that might not be there. That is what's happened all over the world, particularly with small farms. And what we saw there was an alternative, which is that in the new paradigm, you're not necessarily having large-scale production. You have much smaller scale. Now, this is what's happened in steel and paper and so on. You have much smaller factories. And so they have a cheese factory. And we saw everyone coming from all over the place on llamas, some carrying the liters from their one cow on their backs, and others coming on donkeys, and they were coming from all over the place to the cheese factory, which they owned, which was working for them, which had doubled the price that they got, and which allowed their form of life to continue. So that on a material basis, if we look at the material world, that was a wonderful example of an alternative cooperative economy, giving the material necessities of life to them. And what was very interesting is that the traditional way in which common land, common resources, let's say fisheries or water, and the way in which those have been successfully managed through collective decision making and oversight and making of rules and making them observed, those actually also apply. Those also could be seen to apply to the way in which the cheese factory and its operations were run. So there was a direct link, it seems to me, between traditional forms of commerce and the, if you like, the new cooperation. But Annabelle, the interesting question here is that how does the immaterial come into this? Is that those traditional forms of producing the material thing? How does either the old or the new forms of immaterial economy, of knowledge and so on, how does that apply?
Can I also raise a question? Just one of the things that came up was with regards to the youth, so reproducing a culture that is interested in cooperative practices and, mutualization and reciprocity and things. And so just with regards to this relation between material and immaterial, in terms of the immaterial, the youth are more exposed to information and ideas from all over the world today. So maybe that's where the idea of the digital commons and the knowledge commons can come into play, in actually, you know, giving people that that kind of stimulation, you know, young people that stimulation, and to sort of so that they're not, so that they don't feel like they have to leave to go to the city to get that, you know.
I want to ask Annabelle sort of how she would relate these questions to her own experience in Salinas, and maybe you can relate some of the background.
Yeah, well, it's interesting because I think this obviously in Salinas you have a process which does seem to have this, you know, there's a huge kind of material evidence of a set of kind of social and economic relations which are manifesting in the form of cheese factories, chocolate factories, nougat factories, essential oil factories. We've got that, we didn't see that yesterday. Yarn factories, women who are knitting. It seems incredibly dynamic in material terms. And I'll go back and address how that came into being. But I think in just with reference to this question of the relation between the immaterial and the material, I think it's a really interesting point that while we were there, one of the key questions that, one of the key problems that was being raised with the leaders that we talked to was precisely this question of how, what you were saying, how do we actually reproduce this knowledge? So the biggest question is not necessarily, you know, how to per se sort of keep this thing going in material terms, but how do we transfer this between ourselves? And for me as an anthropologist, I mean, I finished my PhD project on Salinas in 2010, and I'm returning in 2014. It was very interesting for me to see how when we went to speak to different organizations within the network of foundations, cooperatives, micro-enterprises that we visited, that actually there were many slippages of communication between those different bodies, that actually we're talking about transferring knowledge in the flock, we're talking about transferring knowledge at vast scales, and yet we're in a tiny place made up of 1,200 people, probably a few more, and there are massive communication problems in terms of how knowledge gets shared between institutions and bodies, between people who are living actively in the same place, sleeping in the same place in most instances. And yet, somehow, there's a failure of contact between these different bodies. And this has been going on, I mean, I've been going to Salinas since 2002, and we're in 2014, and I still see the same issues, that people in these institutions living in the same places aren't able to communicate between themselves. We're talking about elites who share the same kind of idiom, managerial idiom in many cases. We're not even talking about necessarily the difficulties of relating between the elite and the people who are delivering milk every day. You know, the people who only have one cow, you know. So for me, it was really interesting to see that the biggest issue that was being raised, both by the manager of the cheese factory, by the manager of the Forno Sal, which was one of the foundations we visited, was how do we transmit? So there's a real question around how the knowledge base on the kind of material practices that they've been enacting for the past 40 years actually continues to flow. And not just that, not because actually one of the interesting things about Salinas is that it receives hundreds of people who are coming in to write theses, write studies. I've been one of them. Many people coming in year after year from Italy, from France, from other parts of Ecuador, all coming in and writing vast amounts of material about this. It's not as though we have a problem with the lack of knowledge. Everyone is producing this stuff. We were talking with two people from Greece who were interested in producing a hydroelectric project in Salinas because they have water. Perhaps there might be a new possibility for generating energy in the area. Salinas already has a study on this. In fact, it already has the beginnings of a project. But for somehow it doesn't quite get implemented. What are the difficulties with actually implementing knowledge which is already available? What about the difficulty of actually the proliferation of knowledge? Salinas has a vast library of different studies that have already been done by multiple people. So I think one of the issues is not that knowledge isn't there, it's available, but how on earth does one actually absorb it? And I think in some respects this relates to recent questions around big data. I think Salinas has become a site for the generation of large amounts of data, large amounts of material, but how on earth do we transfer it in terms to local people in such a way that it can actually be materialized? So So in my terms, I think one of the issues is not so much that knowledge isn't available to people, but how on earth we can actually access it, implement it, act on it.
Can I ask a question to you? You heard we had a comment this morning when we went to South Quito Housing Co-op, and we asked if they were receiving any support or financial support, moral. I think he referred to moral support, ethical support, and he said no, nada, nada, nada. Mm. And then he, you know, without us saying anything about Salinas, he said, it all goes to Salinas. That they get funding, they get the development support coming from the international cooperation movement, et cetera, et cetera. So it was very interesting, having been in those two places within 24 hours. Did you pick up on that?
And how did you find the problem you're identifying in Salinas?
Is it dependency?
How did you find that in South Quito? Was there a difference in the way they were socializing their own knowledge amongst themselves?
Yes, well, I think Salinas is very used to receiving in some ways it is a kind of knowledge economy, I think, in some senses, Salinas. It's very used to receiving interventions in the form of studies, for example. It's also very used to, in a sense, short of saying that there's a sense in which people can kind of take it or leave it, I think, in Salinas in that respect. So Salinas, to give a little bit of background, it's emerged in a very different way from the kind of project that we saw in the south of Quito today, and I think that is very instrumental in terms of what it's become. It was a town that in 1970 had quite high levels of poverty. It was very dependent on an hacienda, which was actively exploiting its labour. It was dependent on salt resources, many of the local people in the area were extracting salt and then had to pay quite a large amount of it to the hacienda in tribute. In about 1970, a group of missionaries from Italy, who formed part of a group called Operación Mato Grosso, arrived under the auspices of the local diocese and were invited, basically, to begin their pastoral work in the area in combination with a program of kind of economic change. And the man who ended up becoming the mover and shaker in Salinas was an Italian priest called Padre Antonio Polo. And he began by starting a cooperative with local people, which enabled them to take control of the salt mines that they had been living on for many generations. And it also coincided with a land reform movement, which meant that at the same time the hacienda was beginning to disappear. And into this new paradigm, they began to produce many, many different kinds of products. So on the basis of this cooperative movement, there's been a kind of multiplication of different kinds of social enterprises, different kinds of enterprises, micro-enterprises, producing cheese, chocolate, nougat, textiles, and with that a kind of a whole array of new social possibilities. And what we were hearing during our visit to this place yesterday was the difficulties, really, of continuing to innovate, to use your word, which came up yesterday, to continue to innovate under very new social, political and economic conditions which are emerging in the world. How do we continue to compete with other kinds of organisations which may be able to produce it much more cheaply than we can? And how do we continue to transmit this to our young people in such a way that this remains relevant to them when, in fact, as you were suggesting, they're becoming interested in different kinds of products? How can we bring into this domain, which is very material, very concerned with kind of quite basic production of, you know, that's to do with production lines between, you know, cattle and milk and making cheese every day, which involves a lot of manual labour. to integrate these new kinds of knowledge practices which are inherent in the digital revolution which is happening today, and in which many young people in Salinas are very interested in and travelling off to Quito, travelling even outside of the country to learn more about. So one of the issues that was being raised by local leaders was how do we bring these two things into line? And there are lots of possibilities, but it needs to be there needs to be a new mode of experimentation, if you like, in order to work out how that might emerge.
And South Quito?
And South Quito in terms
of how does that compare? Okay. Did you notice any way, any differences in the way they were trying to share the knowledge and innovate amongst themselves?
Well, as we were discussing earlier today, I think one of the key issues that I noticed in South Quito was the real concern from the outset, in some ways, as a sort of more slightly more intentioned act on the transmission of cooperativism, almost as their reason for being. So there was a real emphasis on education. So they had invested in a school. In Salinas, for example, there's the schooling has really been left to the state. In south of Quito, it really was the cooperative that kind of it actually established its own cooperative school. In Salinas, the school is still state run. So, and we also have a concern for an aesthetic, as you mentioned as well. So there's a real concern about what this space looks like and feels like to be in, and that in itself is exemplary of the cooperative process. You have this very beautiful park, and then this wonderful jungle-like area which is full of native trees and really tells us about what Quito might once have been and what it could again be. In Salinas, I think there's been a much stronger focus on resolving basic economic needs, and perhaps there's been less of an emphasis, I think, on this question of transmission, which is partly why I think it's reaching a really critical stage now.
I want to raise a point. And it comes in a way, it takes it back to this main, this key question of the immaterial versus the material. And this notion that if we sort of create a kind of a knowledge commons, you know, through the assistance, actually very much focused on digital technology, that this is somehow going to have a transformative and positive impact on actual social relations. And I really wonder about this. I really have deep skepticism, actually, about it. You raise the point that in Salinas, people have been working together for 50 years. Even now, are having challenges in actually, you know, sharing information, sharing knowledge, and then replicating it, innovating on it, and then passing it on. And so I really have, so the question is a social question. It's a question of, you know, interactions between people, actual people, with the quality of their social relationships. That is really the circuit, the social circuit through which knowledge is shared and replicated and so on. And I wonder whether the introduction of this question of the immaterial social knowledge, you know, comments, to what extent that's actually going to have an impact on that, whether it will have any impact on that, or whether it really goes the other way around, whether it's the quality of the social relations and the social organizations in the material world that actually determine, you know, how the immaterial is actually produced and reproduced
most
and shared.
Most definitely.
Right? It goes the other way.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm wondering about.
No, I mean, I think that's absolutely crucial, because I mean the whole point that I'm making is that there for about, well, how long has Salinas been a real model? I mean, probably since the early 1980s, Salinas has been an exemplar both kind of nationally and internationally. It's had received hordes of visitors, hordes of volunteers, all producing new modes of knowledge about what's going on, social capital, the way the cooperatives work, whatever it might be, hydroelectric plants. All this stuff is stashed away, and what they now have is the Centro de Relaciones Académicas. They have, it's called CRA. And that's been around maybe for about 6 or 7 years, and it's been there precisely to provide a kind of storehouse for all this material. The problem is precisely that there is this proliferation of sort of immaterial knowledge, as it were, the world of knowledge, you know. And yet, as we've seen, there have been huge difficulties with integrating it. So I think it's precisely the fact that that isn't enough. It simply isn't enough. That's not going to do it. Salinas has probably more information about it proportionate to its population than many other places in the world. So what I think is interesting about the cooperative process in Salinas is that there has is that the way that cooperativism was manifested was precisely through material processes. Now, one of the things that's so interesting about the place is that Catholicism and the church provided a space that was at once social and political and economic. The church became a site of a kind of integrated development process, if you like, whereby values and knowledge values, if you like, and these very material practices merged and came together. Now, I'm not saying that was a perfect process, I don't want to paint it as a kind of perfect utopia, but what I think was so successful about what happened in Salinas was precisely that this priest managed to mobilize a kind of integration of the material and the immaterial in that sense, if you like. And it was only because of those very concrete practices, and I mean through the flows of cheese and products around that parish, that facilitated the social relations that enabled things to actually happen. It's not that social relations kind of happened on their own. They're not. They've always emerged through very, very material practices, which is why I question, I'm not sure that this divide between the material and the immaterial ultimately serves us very much. All these social relations were enacted through flows of products, and they always have been. It wasn't that Salinas suddenly in the 1970s started doing this. Alcohol, contraband alcohol was circulating. These were what enabled kin relationships to be stabilised and re-established and reenacted and reiterated at every stage. And cheese was always in circulation. Different kinds of products were always in circulation. So I think we need to be aware of the ways in which knowledge and affect, if you like, affective, intimate social relations get materialised through these different kinds of flows of products and goods. And the priest and his volunteers and all the other people who were integrated with that process all enacted and reenacted that long history of product flows. So I agree, I think it's absolutely about finding ways. How do we enact these values, these knowledges, through new material practices?
I agree with John. But you observe something very real and very significant, and that is a kind of alienation of young people wanting to connect with this new world and feeling detached from the history of the recent history, but very significant history of Salinas. And that has to, I mean, one has to take account of that, one has to be cognizant of that. But the issue and the contrast with South Quito, with the school and working with children at a very early stage in life and imbibing these values, which are not just to create cooperatives, it was around human rights and the environment and so on. And also South Quito is on the edge of a city, so you're dealing with a semi-urban population and you're dealing with a very remote population of young people who have access to not just knowledge but a whole world that their parents, who built up the society, didn't have access to, knew nothing about, and so there was this mobilization. So there's several questions. One is the intergenerational transfer of the existing knowledge so that the local economy can continue to function. And that's a very, very big question, because is there a threat of these young people leaving? You were telling us that many of them are going to school, outside and, quite far away. Do they come back? So the issue then is what do you do to retain young people? I mean, not to capture them and make them, feel obliged to stay because of family and tradition and so on. And it's not about creating a fab lab or some social innovation lab in the center of town. But how do you bring in some of this, how do you bring in culture, how do you bring in some kind of dynamism that is, a creative way in which young people can participate and create new sectors, within that local community. I don't think that that's something that's impossible, so that the attraction, the allure of that digital universe and all that it promises, you know, it can be translated into very concrete community centers with artistic, you know, production, music, theater, you know, however it can be expressed, because there seemed to be an absence of that. I mean, I don't want that after just being there for one day. It's very difficult to make any statements that are so conclusive. But there appeared to be an absence of. There's a community center and there's a place to reflect on practices and so on. But there didn't seem to be a sort of cool place where young people could hang out and perhaps engage in different sets of practices. So one is an urban situation, you know, where people, and then the other is a very remote community with different challenges, I think.
Could I raise one contrasting issue between the two, which is a deep one, going far beyond these two things, which is the relationship between, if you like, the new knowledge workers, the technical class, the experts, and ordinary people.
Yes.
In the case of South Quito, they required a lot of expert knowledge in building the houses, in designing them. They needed engineers and architects and heating specialists and so on. And those who were involved, the community leaders who were involved, were very clear. They made very striking remarks. One was that the tendency for experts is to try and avoid problems, whereas they found that in making a project, a collective project, problems were good, but you had to go through the problem in order to be generative, in order to create something that came out of people's desires and visions of what they would like. And indeed, he said that experts do not allow utopias to be realized. I took him to be saying that the experts should be servants, not masters. And he gave us an example, the way in which the architect produced designs which had the kitchens in the darkest place.
Yes, she told us that.
And that, in fact, what they did is to say, we want the kitchen to be in the lightest place because it should be the center of the house. And that whole way in which they co-designed that house, those houses, which were themselves, and we entered them very remarkable in that way, very aspirational for all of us. That those forms of co-design between the experts and those the users, but with their own knowledges about what they and their work, that seemed to me to be an ideal that we would obviously like translated into the way the state operated, but which also might have lessons for Quito, for Las Salinas, where the operation of many of those factories actually had been taken out and was being managed, if you like, by the experts, with international people coming in, and without that co-design and co-production that we saw in South Quito.
Mm-hmm. I think that's true, and I think it's not even, I mean, I think one of the issues in Salinas is not even that it's only international experts coming in to resolve problems, but also you have quite a powerful split between managers, people who are now managers of those foundations, many of whom have come in from outside, having not been born and bred, if you like, in Salinas, and have implemented a process which is actually quite distant and separate from normal salineros, who actually feel very disconnected from the process. Precisely because there isn't much sharing actually in the reflections that take place every Monday, where institutions are kind of invited to think through all these issues in Salinas with local people. Actually, it's really only the managers who attend those, the institutional representatives that actually attend those reflections. So there isn't much diffusion of knowledge even between different people in the town. So I think what I noticed was just more of a split, really, between the kind of managerial experts who run the day-to-day, who deal with the everyday management of those institutions, and the normal people who work there. And that hasn't really been resolved. And that has I think led to another crisis, which was one of the other crises that was mentioned in Salinas, which is there's a crisis of leadership, partly because local people aren't in a position really to audit and evaluate and watch over how the management is run. They don't know, they don't see it, they're not exposed to it. So there's a real problem with, I don't want to call it monitoring, but just participation of local people in the everyday functioning of the institutions that they're meant to be a part of. So it leads on to that.
I'm thinking maybe we should try and draw this to a close. So in a sense, to return to this question of, you know, what this project is aspiring to in terms of, you know, addressing the question of social knowledge. And then the work that we've been doing, which is, what is the social analog, you know, in terms of actual organizations and actual relationships in community, in places where we work and live together, people. How do these two, in a sense, relate to each other? And I think there's a deep, intimate connection between the two. But I haven't really kind of clarified in my own mind what are the mechanisms through which, because the challenge of enclosure and privatization and commodification of the immaterial of knowledge, of experience, and so on is real. And I think it's a critical question. And if it's not addressed, even at that level of patent, of copyright, you know, access to commodification, for example, of traditional knowledge, right? And if that isn't actually dealt with on its own terms, that the prevailing paradigms and systems of exploitation and control and domination that exist in the material world will only be intensified. Because that's what it serves. I mean, ultimately, the privatization and commodification of knowledge is to reinforce, you know, systems of domination and control over the material world, over how people buy and sell, and how they relate to each other, and how people live together, the work that they do and how they work. So I just want to sort of maybe close this by sort of maybe some final comments about, you know, what is it, how do you actually translate, right, this aspiration towards, you know, this kind of utopian digital world of social knowledge into mechanisms that reinforce the kind of things that we're talking about, the social, the solidarity, the mutual, the reciprocal. And I think that, in a sense, is still the crux of the problem, because you can't ignore the enclosure of immaterial goods. You know, that has to be addressed. But how then do you actually make that relevant to the practicalities of actually, you know, reclaiming the commons and the social in community? How do you do that? So there you go.
Well, what this conversation has suggested to me is really helpful is we take the social knowledge economy, then I think we understand economy, that's to say, is to actually produce knowledge, you know, is a material thing, and you actually have to produce it and then circulate it, and it can be circulated in all sorts of ways. So there is an economy there, doesn't float in off the skies. It is something that emerges from us in different ways. The knowledge, okay, we know about knowledge, which is highly complex, all sorts of different types of knowledge. What this conversation has really interrogated is the idea of the social. And one version, one meaning of the social, is as against private. That instead of privatizing this knowledge, it should be socialized. It should be open. It should be free. It should be available on the internet or wherever. But in fact, what you have, Annabelle, have introduced in a very subtle way is that this is not enough. It doesn't float freely. But you have complex sets of relationships that, even in small villages, information can be used in different ways. And appropriated for power internally, even though formally it is social. Nevertheless, it doesn't float free of complex social structures, and that there are interrelationships between the way in which A, and the material economy develops, and how that then affects power relations, but also in the way in which one manages, you know, how you organize the administration of common things, of the cheese factory, or the forest. And here I think there is a great agenda for research, just as there's been this remarkable research on how common resources are successfully managed. Many are not successfully managed. The Japanese fishing fleet comes in and takes all the fish because the local communities haven't been able to manage those adequately. But the late Eleanor Ostrom's remarkable work has identified, I think it is eight things you always find in the successful management of commons. And in a way, what I feel the agenda is can we similarly look closely at all the ways in which cooperatives and other forms of that type of commons, how those, and indeed how all the internet and software, how those are also commons. When is that successfully managed? And when is it not successfully? What has to happen for it to be a successful sharing of this without it getting appropriated by others within a co-op or within a community for their own specific rather than social community purpose?
To pick up on that and perhaps not answer your question directly, John, but I think Annabelle's comments about the transmission problem, the intergenerational, and not just intergenerational, but even in the workspace and in the community, that there is a proprietary knowledge that the elite is not sharing adequately to be able to empower others to feel that they have a sense of ownership. So that these are very, very complex issues that are above and beyond. I mean, they are the social, because we can't simply say that because a cooperative exists, and we know that, that it's a model of democratic governance and sharing. We have an example here. And I don't think this is a deliberate model where people set out to take control and subvert. I don't suggest that at all. But it's a reality, and I think these things have to be addressed. But again, I would come back to the appropriation of technology that is also ongoing by networks. Networks, and I would underscore networks, is what goes on in the individual cooperative, but there are networks of groups nationally and internationally that are challenging that way of thinking and doing. And this is where the internet has become extremely powerful and useful, and even under its current proprietary organization of being owned privately, we're capturing these spaces, we're creating the capacity to communicate and the Salinas story, again in contrast with South Quito, is very much the old model of how it's been structured internally and how these experts have come in, or not experts, but researchers, endless researchers and development workers and so on. Yeah, this morning we heard that there's none of that. It's really being built from below. And we suggested, and this is again perhaps old, the old world, but a more positive reading of the old world, of having exchanges of experiences where people could learn from what they are doing, because I think what they're doing is very radical. And I'd come back to the kitchen example. Not only were we told that the kitchen in the co-design should not be in a dark space, we were also told, and I heard this very clearly, that the kitchen is not a place for service. That food is communal, and it's sharing, and the preparing of food is part of the household. And by closing it off in a dark room, it turns it into a service for others. So, I mean, all this to say, I think of experiences of platforms now where we're developing markets, solidarity markets, the fair trade economy, which you know well, and of course there are contradictions in there, and people appropriate these spaces. as well. So to me, the you know, creating an information commons, creating a technology commons, is part of a process which is not dissimilar from the Eleanor Ostrom story of managing collectively managing resources, or producing goods and services collectively with, you know, with objectives that are that reflect the desires, the hopes, the capacities of communities, of civil society. So I think we have to be really careful, because there are a lot of smart people out there, and the digital world is very, very seductive. And that is, you know, and yes, cognitive capitalism and the necessity to create Linux spaces and so on. But we can't make this mistake of separating the immaterial from the material. The challenges in the material world are enormous. I mean, we can see it here, but we can go to the United States and Canada and very prosperous countries and see the same challenges.
I think I'd like to say a couple of things on the basis of what maybe we've seen in Salinas. I think firstly, I think we see in Salinas a kind of microcosm of the sort of complexity of things. We've talked about it as it being a traditional model. It's also a space which is becoming very multiplicitous, I would say. And I think what we see there, and I've already raised this in another way before, is the problem of translation. You have new spaces of expertise and technical specialism which are being generated around particular kinds of products and particular kinds of new kind of emerging knowledge practices, which are there to sort of facilitate new product lines, new kinds of training, whatever it might be. And what I think I see as a researcher now, kind of coming back after 4 years, is the difficulty of generating shared idioms which enable those different hubs of technical knowledge to communicate between one another. And I think that's an interesting, it's an interesting microcosm for the kinds of processes we see at scale as well. So, however, on a more hopeful note, I think it's also possible to see in Salinas, I mean, we've said that there's a division between the experts and everybody else, and there is a degree to which that's true. But I think what you also see is a real, is that where you have powerful hubs of power, of expert power, you also have creative margins. And I think in Salinas you actually increasingly see a kind of a response coming up from young people, and from people who have, young people who are maybe now in their 30s and 40s, who have left that model in their 20s and are kind of returning, wanting to come back to Salinas but in a new way, and they're critical of the old leadership practices, and they're coming back with new tools, new ideas and new mechanisms, and they're wanting to do it outside of the system but in a way that's related to it. So what you see are, for example, I have two friends who are interested in generating a permaculture project, but they're wanting to do it with us with social ends, with social objectives that would feed the Salinero system as it currently stands, but on new terms, and one that doesn't fit neatly into the existing institutional model. And I see this as extremely rich. So I think, even as we might say that there are real problems around leadership and around people's alienation from power processes, how do we materialise these things? Actually, this in itself, these problems in itself, as we heard today in the south of Quito, the problems themselves generate new forms of rich and creative and innovative responses, and I think we absolutely cannot leave that out. And in Salinas, I think there are lots of hopeful signs that suggest that the process will not reproduce itself in a simple way, but will generate kind of multiplicitous new responses, I think, as well.
We could bring that back to the flock, our flock discussions. And the hopeful thing is that I felt in all the contributions there really was a commitment by these new knowledge, all of us, knowledge workers, for inclusivity. But how that is done is a very delicate one. But if we, I think that needs to be emphasised within, as well as the open, that commitment to be inclusive, and how those two, very often two different types of knowledges are, it's not quite integrated, but it's how they relate in a generative fashion. And the danger of any new class, as I've called it, is that they then, it is an excuse for their own the assumption of their own power against the rest of the society. And the positive side, the one that must be kept right at the front, is, if you like, the power that these new knowledge workers have is then not appropriated by them against the rest of society, but makes, as it were, its alliances and its commitment to being truly social and not appropriated by them.
I'm glad you raised the question of power, which is another video for another time. But I think it's a good point to end on. Because what we are really talking about is the nature of power and the tools that power uses to increase its power. And that's as true in the material realm of hacienda, landlords, and local meal producers, or a Google or a Facebook in the immaterial world, and the power it concentrates through the utilization and design of digital tools that increase that. So ultimately, it does come back to this. It comes back to the nature of power and how to socialize power, in a sense. How do you distribute power? How do you decentralize and distribute it, and so that it becomes possible to be inclusive, so it does become possible to actually share knowledge without feeling that you're losing something, right? That it's a collective value that is being produced. So, the whole history of the cooperative movement, of the social economy, is about how to distribute socialized power in democracy. It's the story of democracy, and that is as true in the immaterial world as it has been in the material world. So, it's the same problem. It's ultimately the same problem. It's been manifested in very peculiar ways when we talk about, social knowledge and the lack of it, the enclosure of the immaterial affect of people. But it's the same problem. It always comes down to that. The appropriation of power for private gain versus the distribution of power for social benefit, right? Anyway.
So, Flock, we should really introduce a C into it, not just F-L-O-K, but F-L-O-C-K, which is free, lean, open, community knowledge.
I like it.
I like it too.
Approved.
And we can be a flock, more easily than
okay.
A flock.
We'll send them a memo.
Yeah, it's a good way, good end.
Okay, thanks very much, everyone.
Thank you, it's fun.